एवरीवन, एम आई ऑडिबल? यस, आई एम ऑडिबल. सो वी विल बिगिन. टुडे अटेंडेंस इज पुअर. So today we are going to deal with, first we have to get yesterday's MCQ, and then we will come to today's study. Okay? So yesterday we had discussed the food processing and related aspects. Today we are going to attempt the question. Questions are not important. The technique, how you are going to approach, how you are going to make an approach while solving the preliminary examination question, that is the most important part. Together we will be solving many such questions. Even I don't know the answers to it, but we will try to find out the answer. Even if you don't know the exact answer, but still there is a scope to make a smart guess. Okay. So the first question you read. Consider the following statements. Before going for statements, the keyword is correct statements. So food processing typically involves harvested crops, butchered animals, products, and uses these products. Long shelf life products. True. No wrong word is there. Food processing is transformation of raw ingredient into food or food into other forms. This is also true. So they are asking for correct statements. So answer must be C. Which is C? So first statement is true. We have seen the history, etc. Increasing the shelf value and nutritional value is the aim of food processing. Consider the following statements, and here we need to find the keyword is correct one. So more than 50% of Indian population work in the industrial sector. Wrong. It's the agri sector. Okay. Food processing units act as a link between agriculture and industry. This is true. So one is wrong, two is correct. So answer must be B. It is B. Yes, it is agricultural enterprise. And 50% is involved. Consider the following statements. The keyword here that we need to focus is incorrect statement. So the upstream stage of production process involves searching for and extracting raw material. So upstream, you must remember the diagram. These are the upstream and this supply down, these are downstream. So raw material comes here. So yes, it is true. The downstream in the production process involves processing the materials collected during the upstream stage into finished products. True. Here it is preparation and distribution. So both statements are right, but they are asking for incorrect. So none is incorrect. So neither one, neither two. D is the answer. Choose the requirements of the downstream from the following. Okay. So accessibility to raw material. This is upstream. Modern extraction techniques. This is downstream. No, this is ambiguous. Organized retail stores for faster distribution. This is distribution. So it is downstream. Latest processing, downstream. Quality testing, downstream. Good linkages with farmer. So this is collection of raw materials. So this is upstream. So 1 and 6 you need to eliminate. Where there is statement 1 eliminated, statement 1 eliminated, statement 6 eliminated. You remain with just your answer, 3, 4, 5. C is the answer, C is the answer. Consider the following statements about supply chain management. Supply chain management is the management of flow of goods, true. It includes movement and storage of raw materials, true. Inventory, true. Finished goods, true. From the point of origin to the point of consumption, yes, that is all SCM all about. The manufacturer does the final processing of this component to make the food product. This completes only the first stage of supply. True. Consider the following about National Mission on Food Processing, 2012 by Ministry of Food Processing. So what is the statement? Ministry of Industry and Commerce, wrong. It is the Ministry of Food Processing, MOFPI. Launched new centrally sponsored, yes, it is a centrally sponsored scheme, not a central sector scheme. With National Mission on Food Processing in 2012. Here is right, but ministry is wrong. So, first is wrong. The mission is expected to improve ministry's outreach significantly in terms of planning, supervision, monitoring of various schemes apart from playing more important purpose. This is a right answer, must be B. This answer is B. Consider the following statements on mega food parks. Okay. The scheme of mega food parks aims at providing a mechanism to link agricultural production to the market by bringing together farmers, businesses, and retailers. The mega food park scheme is a cluster-based approach, right, in which has well-defined agri horticultural processing zone containing state-of-the-art processing facilities, true, in support of infrastructure and logistics and supply. True, correct. Both are correct. Yes, both are correct. What is pink revolution? These such questions, I don't think they are going to ask. But meat and poultry production, because Prime Minister in his, when during his, I think, 2014 speech, once mentioned this term, pink revolution. So A is the answer. This is the answer. Golden revolution. So, it is golden fiber, I guess. I don't think it may be answer, but jute is golden fiber revolution, whereas apiculture is golden revolution. Yes, no. Yeah. This is golden fiber. This is jute. Golden revolution is horticulture and honey production. Honey production is called as apiculture. Consider the following statements about food processing organizations. These are democratic under Companies Act amended in 2013. Now 2019 amendment is there. It is YK Alag Committee. YK Alag Committee has recommended giving legislation backing. More power, more professionalism, less governance, more autonomy to such organization. APMC reforms must be done so as to accommodate the FPOs. FPOs are professionally handled, but benefits are equally shared by a group of farmers. They are cluster-based approach. Okay, this is in a democratic way. So, इतनी सारी चीजें आपको याद होनी चाहिए. When a concept pops up, these are the things that you need to remember. If you write YK Alag Committee on FPO, you get one extra mark. If you write Meena Kumari Committee on Fishery Production, you get one extra mark. If you write Vivek Debroy Committee on Railway Reforms, you get one extra mark. If you write Kasturi Rangan Committee and Gadgil Committee on Western Ghats, you get one extra mark. If you write Nilima Shir Sagar Committee on Fixed Combination, you get one extra mark. If you write your committee recommendations are essential, because they give legitimacy to your answers. So this is how you should approach in the mains, but that is for the mains. Choose the correct statements. FPO is a producer company, right? A producer company, a cooperative company, a society, or any other legal form which provides for sharing of profits and benefits among the members, right? The main of FPO is to ensure better income for producers through organization of their own, right? Which is the committee on doubling farmer income? Ashok Dalwai committee, one extra mark. Choose the correct statements. Both are correct. C must be the answer, C is the answer. So this is how we have completed the discussion of multiple choice question. Now we will go for today's another important topic, the technological interface in agriculture, infrastructure, etc., etc. Kisi ko doubt hai? Anyone have doubt regarding the discussion we had? If no, then we will proceed to today's lecture. So we will proceed. Yes, I will definitely I will again explain balance of payment. Just remind me at the end of the class. I'm sure. E technology in the aid of 1 year. So as we know that UPSC since 2017, the prelims question paper and also mains from 2019, they have made everything dynamic with main focus being on the technological disruptions that are happening all around the world in literally every field. So agriculture with no exception, it also is important because we are an agrarian country, and agricultural distress and rural distress is a regular picture every year, because our agriculture is monsoon based and monsoon is erratic in nature. Monsoons are flexible. There is no surety that monsoons will come on a fixed date, on a fixed time. Sometimes there is excess of rainfall. Sometimes there is a deficit in rainfall. Even the raining pattern is not well interspaced. With 80% precipitation in India comes only in 100 days. So this is also not a good thing for agriculture, because sustained moisture is not maintained. Wet spell and alternate dry spells, that are not good for any agriculture or any cropping activity. So the erratic nature of monsoon, the unpredictability of monsoon, and the climate change, global warming, is impacting Indian agriculture like anything, because the South Asian countries will be worst hit because of the sea level rise and the climate change. Because South Asian countries, they are the developing countries, plus they are agro-based economies, plus densely populated. So developing countries, agro-based economies, densely populated, and we have much to lose. Our stakes are very high. So if there is 10 centimeter rise, if there is even 2 centimeter rise in average sea level, then the level of impact that India will face will be very high as compared to what Canada or USA will face, because these are the parameters. So to reduce the agricultural distress and to improve the situation, definitely technology will come to rescue. So the government and the civil society, agricultural scientists, are focusing on technological upgradation in agriculture. So as you can see, agricultural practices and advancement differ globally, definitely, because different agroclimatic zones are there in any region. Even a single state, India is a very vast and diverse country. Even a single state, for example, take any state, if you take Uttar Pradesh, then the example, this is Uttar Pradesh, then this will be the agroclimatic zones. Western UP is very prosperous and well irrigated, whereas this areas near Bagelkhand and Bundelkhand, they are drought hit areas, and this Purvanchal is different agroclimatic zone. So even within any state of country, there is no uniform climatic zone. So the agricultural diversity is very huge, and to make any one policy, it won't be good, because one size does not fit all. So a different approach for specific requirement of that area. So different technology has to be there. Now, agriculture in India is a core sector. Yes, it is the largest employment generator, food security, nutritional security, and sustainable development. Poverty elevation, true, because most of the poor in our country, they are engaged in agricultural activity only. So any betterment of our agricultural enterprise will definitely be a tool for poverty eradication. And it is a paradox that it's actual, according to new Niti Aayog report, it is 13.4% of GDP. So with 53% of population involved, the output is only 13.4% of GDP. What a mismatch. Means it's like giving, and what is the service sector? Service sector is very minimal, with hardly, I think, 11% of employment comes from service sector, which gives us 64% of GDP. So it's like 11 people are having 64 rupees and 53 people are having only 13 rupees. So that shows why agriculture, or why farmers are poor, whereas those who are in service sector, they are economically well off. These are the statistics. This is the paradox of India. With this enterprise, with largest generator of employment, gives only 30% of output, whereas it consumes 80% of fresh water. So this is a mismatch. Okay? And this paradox was explained by economic survey. So these are various schemes we will be looking in detail. E-agriculture, what is e-agriculture? It is a convergence. If you should write like this. Traditional agriculture and information and communication technology, ICT interface. you should like this in a diagram, and this will be the e-agriculture, e-agri. These are the innovative diagrams that help you in the final examination. Now, if you write this, you need not write anything in detail. Traditional agriculture and ICT interface. This is the interface where e-agriculture is there. It is the interface of fusion of traditional agricultural practices with the modern ICT technologies, and that is e-agriculture. Your diagram is self-explanatory. This is how the examiner will definitely appreciate your innovative way of explaining things, complicated things, in a simple way. And that is one of the job of IAS officer, because once you go into the service, the people that will be coming to you or to your office, they won't be that intelligent, they won't be that learned, they won't be that empowered, they won't be having any specific knowledge or expertise about the problem they are facing. So you have to deal with all kind of people. So it's your job to explain or to address their concern or their complaints in the simplest possible way, in the best way that they can understand. So this is how you, that's why UPSC appreciates when you come out with something innovative thing in your answers. But that should be relevant. That should not be very vague or ambiguous, or only you are getting what you are writing and nobody can understand what you are writing. It's like you are writing in some kind of Fibonacci code, and only you can crack it, and examiner is not able to crack it. So he will punish you. So simpler things means general things which are generally understood. Okay. So when it comes, the convergence of government policies should be such that the focus should be on the digital empowerment. But this to happen, there should be digital connectivity in rural areas. So there is a mission going on for digital connectivity. Some Bharat 2.0, some mission is there, but that we will learn later. Soil management, watershed management, seed management, fertilizer management, pest management, harvest management. These are agricultural components, but technology aid can be there. So what can be done in soil management? So soil health card, every 3 years. Water management, what technology can do in water management is first, digital mapping of aquifers, underground aquifers. The mission is called as Atal Bhujal Yojana. Atal Bhujal Yojana, where drones will be used with infrared readings, and they will make a surveillance, and they will map the underground water aquifers, the underground water streams, because we don't have data. Obviously, we don't have data on most of the things. So this is the best one component, that you should have data at the first place, and then you can have another management like micro irrigation, fertigation. In this UPSC 2020, they have asked question on fertigation. In this in the UPSC question 2019, they have asked the benefits of micro irrigation. So water management on the technological interface is very important. Seed management, of course, seed management can be done. Fertilizer management, this is fertigation, technological interface, where fertilizers are dissolved in water and then they are given through drip or sprinkler irrigation, and that's how uniformly not just water but fertilizers are also distributed. So this is maximizing the optimal, this is the efficient mode, where you save water, you save fertilizer, that means you are saving resources. And that's how the cost of agriculture will come down and the profits will be maximized. So in limited resources, profit maximization can be achieved. And that's how we can make our agricultural enterprise sustainable through technological enterprise. What is the traditional way of irrigation of field? It's flooding. The flooding starts from one point of field, and it stays, the pump stays active for 8 to 10 hours till the other point of the land is fertilized. But this is very, because if this is the land and this is the pump, and if for if irrigation pump is started and flooding method, then initially this area will become wet. Then water will start leaching. Then this area will become wet. Either water will start percolating. And to the point when it is reached to this level, the percolation on the start point will be tremendous. Huge amount of water will be lost. So this is not efficient. So this much of water is wasted to the point that water is reached at this point of the farm. So flooding is not water efficient, and that's how we are wasting 80% of our fresh water, underground water, on agriculture with minimal. India is one of the lowest ranking country when it comes to water productivity or water efficiency. So technology can play here a part. You can quote a case study of Maharashtra. Maharashtra, in Maharashtra, sugarcane is the backbone of rural economy of Western Maharashtra, but it is also a water guzzling crop. So government of Maharashtra, instead of banning sugarcane, see, there is no solution. When it comes to farmer or agriculture, government cannot ban anything, because any popular government cannot antagonize the majority of voters, which are farmers or rural people. So instead of banning the technology, the government of Maharashtra has made it compulsory for the farms to have micro irrigation or drip irrigation. If you want sugarcane, you must have micro irrigation, for like, and that to drip one. It is the most water efficient drip irrigation. And government has given 50% subsidy to it. If the cost of this drip infrastructure is 1 lakh rupees, then 50% by farmer and 50% by government, and then only you will get to have sugarcane in your field. Water requirement earlier for sugarcane, if it was 100 liters, now it's just 30 liters. So 70 liters of water is saved. After, this is an example. If 1 kg of urea was required earlier, now only 150 gram is required. So this much efficiency can happen by a simple legislation. So that is the need of modernization of agriculture as input. Another thing, UPS has asked question in, I think, in 2016 about 16 or 17. In 16 also and in 17 also, about neem-coated urea. Neem-coated urea. So this is another technological breakthrough in fertilizer management. See, this is the fertilizer management component. So what neem-coated urea do, the options were, it reduces the fertilizer requirement, which was true statement. It is also reduces the rate of dissolution of urea in water, which is also true. See, if regular urea is put into the field, it immediately dissolves like a salt, which is not good, because plant will have the urea uptake in micrograms, only. So rest of urea will be wasted. In 24 hours, plant will uptake only that much urea which is required for it. That is in micrograms. So we need such type of urea that will dissolve slowly as per the requirement of plant, the plant uptake. So this is how the requirement is also reduced. And third, the third statement was, where most of the people were wrong, because it also reduces the adulteration of urea in other commodities. So most of the people, they didn't know that most of the duplicate milk is made out of urea. Urea is very white. It gives the whiteness to the chemical solution, and it also does not have any smell of its own. So it's So it is very good whitener. Urea plus milk powder plus raw banana powder plus animal oil, animal fat oil, and some emulsifiers will make such a good milk with all the flavor and all the properties of a milk. But it will be a duplicate or chemical or synthesized milk. So this was a very huge challenge, and urea is subsidized for agricultural purposes, but this was misused. Many elements in our country, they make money out of anything. Even I have seen people who are making money in the tragedy of Corona also. Not legitimate money. Money out of unethical means. So this is also one concern from the government. A heavily subsidized product was being misused by the miscreants in our society. So what they did was they coated urea with neem. Now neem, everybody know, neem is technically Acacia indica. Acacia indica. So this Acacia indica, this is very bitter in taste. This is very bitter in taste, and if it is coated on urea, then its adulteration possibility in milk is completely routed out. So these were the benefits of neem. Just a small technological disruption, and a major problem was solved. And this is the importance of technological interference or interface in agriculture, that UPSC strongly stresses on it. 3 to 4 questions were asked, mostly on technological interface. This is the record year where over 16 to 17 questions were from agriculture, and that too out of that 10 questions, means around 65% of questions were technology based in agriculture. Okay, so this is a very important area. And UPSC asks questions on a very general thing, but those are very important, like neem coated urea, as I explained, neem coated urea. In 2017, they had asked about role of gypsum in Indian agricultural soil. Gypsum. What is the role of gypsum? Gypsum is basically a white powder, calcium carbonate derivative. This MCQ I marked wrong in final exam, because I knew various role of gypsum except for one. Statement role was moisture. It increases the moisture retention capacity of soil. Moisture retention. It reduces the alkalinity of soil. This was also a statement. Reduces alkalinity of soil. This is cheap. And fourth option was, it is chemically stable. So this was right, I knew. It is cheap, I knew. It reduces alkalinity or salinity of soil. This also I knew. Increases the, and it improves the texture of soil. This also I knew, but I didn't know anything about moisture retention capacity. This was very common logical. Any calcium carbonate derivative is hygroscopic in nature, which has affinity for water or moisture. So this was a very common sense thing, but I somehow, in the pressure of examination, I didn't get this point, and I opted for this. I knew this much, but I didn't know this one. So I marked it wrong. And this was the question that I could not clear prelims in 2017. So I know the cost of gypsum. Such the general questions. This year they asked about the steel slag in agriculture. Steel slag, copper slag, fly ash. You know where fly ash comes from? Fly ash comes from after burning coal in thermal power station. What is remaining is fly ash. It's the new word, flash bricks. Flash bricks. This is also the probable question that UPSC might ask, because this is the area which has remained untouched. They have asked fly ash, but now new technology of flash bricks. Flash is the condensed version of fly ash bricks. the bricks which are made out of fly ash, they are one thing is you need not to dig out the basin of soil or dam to make the soil brick. So it is an alternative to soil brick. Soil is a very, very important resource. It takes millions of years to make a single gram of soil in a natural process. So the scarce commodity like sand and soil shall be replaced by another thing. This is a waste, and there is a problem of dumping of fly of ash out of thermal station. So the government, again, I know that government of Maharashtra has again made a legislation that all the brick kilns in the vicinity of thermal power plants within 500 kilometers has to make their bricks out of ash, which is cost effective for them also. It also solves the problem of dumping of ash. It also makes an alternate economy, alternate employment. It also saves the soil in the ecosystem. The soil is spared for other productive purposes. It is also a very lightweight brick. If there is an earthquake, then the collapse of the building is less likely because it is very hard, lightweight, durable, and flexible. So earthquake resilient structures can be built out of flash bricks. So this is the important question which might be asked in coming years. So this is the thing, okay? So yes, Bharat Nirman, this is the thing. Bharat Net 2 is the name. Bharat Net 2.0, out of Universal Service Obligation Fund, USOF, through National Optical Fiber Network. Mug up this thing. Bharat Net 2, digital connectivity to all gram panchayats throughout our country. The funding will come from Universal Service Obligation Fund, okay, under the head of National Optical Fiber Network. Okay, this is it. Itna yaad rakho, yehi aapko final mein aayega. Baki Bharat Nirman Kendra is now outdated. Kisan credit card, yes, they will time and again they ask question on this. One of the major reason of agricultural distress or rural distress is inaccessibility to the formal credit line. So Kisan credit card comes in the, now we can argue that there are banks, many banks in rural areas, then why can't farmer go there and ask for money? Because we should know the ground realities that bank has a very tedious process. Even if we are graduates, we are well qualified people, but I can guarantee you the level of harassment that we also will face when you will apply for a loan in a bank, because they are the paperwork, that the complexities, the protocols that need to be followed, the mortgage, the counter property, that all these things, they will make an estimate, they will attach a property of 25 lakh and then they will give you a loan of 10 lakh. So this is a mismatch. This is a very this colonial way of working of our banking system, which need to be reformed. Where in a such way that people like Mallya or Nirav Modi or Mehul Choksi, they get the loan very easily, but the genuine entrepreneurs, they face very hassle on this road. So what about farmer? They are not empowered. They are not that much literate. They don't know much of the protocol of the financial official financial details of anything. So that's why Kisan credit card is a very easy thing for them. It bypasses the cumbersome process of the bank, and easy credit, very less interest. Also the interest subvention scheme on Kisan credit card was announced by our finance minister 2 years back, where 2% interest credits will be given if they repay loan on time. Okay, this is the Kisan Chaupal. You don't need to remember. This is also not. This is very important question. They have not asked on these two important things. High probability that this will be the focus area. I mean, because these are the proper technological nerve centers in Indian agricultural system built in these 2 years. So now they are hot topics. So you can expect a question from here. Village Knowledge Center serves as information dissemination center. Name itself suggests knowledge center hai wo. जहाँ ट्रेनिंग होगी जहाँ डेटा दिया जाएगा स्टेटस ऑफ योर फार्म सॉइल व्हाट शुड यू ग्रो व्हाट यू शुड नॉट ग्रो हाउ यू शुड फर्टिलाइज हाउ यू शुड फर्टिगेट हाउ शुड यू शुड हार्वेस्ट हाउ शुड मार्केट एवरीथिंग रिलेटेड टू एग्रीकल्चर नॉलेज सेंटर वेयर एग्री ब्रेन वेयर जूनियर साइंटिस्ट वाइंटिस्ट बिठाएंगे वहां पे विलेज रिसोर्स सेंटर VRC फर्स्ट थिंग दैट शुड कम इन योर माइंड इज इट इज एन इनिशिएटिव बाय इसरो Yes, it's slow. Satellite-based mapping. ISRO, along with some credible NGOs, have started this initiative, are connected to knowledge expert cells like agricultural university, skill development institute, hospitals. Okay. In this slide, they have not mentioned ISRO, but VRC is the brainchild of ISRO. And ISRO is the main organization that is driving this thing, where satellite-based connectivity will be given. If there is a problem of water leaching in the Rayalaseema region, but the expertise is sitting in the University of Punjab, then ISRO will make sure that these two people. These two institutions will be connected along with other requirements, and that is how the question or the problem will be solved in an integrated way. Okay. Irrigate via smartphone. Yes, I have personally used this thing. Mobile is playing a big role in monitoring and controlling the crop irrigation system. With right equipment, a farmer can control his irrigation system from a phone or computer instead of drive to each field. I remember. I am a passionate farmer. To the year 2016, I was actively in the farm field along with my medical profession. Whenever I was on holidays in my home district, never a day went that I was not in my field by say 7 a.m. to the sunset, because this is a regular activity in my side. Of Marathwada. So what was the challenging thing? Because now load shedding is not there, electricity supply is regular, but to the year of 2016, in my memory, I remember electricity in the village was only for 12 hours, and on this was a domestic consumption line, and for agriculture line, irrigation line, it was only for 2 hours from 2 a.m. to 4 a.m. and that too only on Fridays. So only on Friday for 2 hours, from 2 a.m. at night to 4 a.m. at night. This was the timing of electricity. So someone from the family, which was mostly me when I was there, need to stay in the farm 25 kilometers away from my residence. It's a complete forest hill area, like a forest or hill area. So that was very challenging. When light was there, we need to start the pump to 4 a.m. Now we start our electricity pump through the cell phone. Just give a missed call, and it will start. It will automatically stop after 45 minutes. If you want to restart, just give another missed call, which is free of cost. It will again start for 45 minutes and automatically shut off. So it's a beautiful technology. Now nobody from us need to stay in the farm at night. So this is how technology has empowered. I have personally felt the empowerment because of the technological interference in our agriculture. So smartphone, I remember that I have written this thing because I have personally experienced this thing. GPS mapping, yes. Another high yield area in prelims, regularly ask about the GPS mapping. I remember they have asked in 2019 that drone can measure the chlorophyll content. Drone can measure the chlorophyll content in a field, agricultural field. Yes, it can. This is how the health of the field will be mapped through a drone. Okay. Benefits, you know. Also, just remember, ENAM is another thing that you should read about after reading this. Okay. Problems, connectivity, digital divide, less of infrastructure, ignorant behavior of our society, the literacy rate, digital literacy. Now the most of the people, they are very much literate, but they are not digitally literate. So what about the training? Even if they are literate, then infrastructure is the problem. Infrastructure is the problem. If they have electricity, then they don't have mobile networks. If they have mobile networks, they don't have the regular electricity. So this is even gender divide in technology. Now in a rural household, all the male members carry smartphone, but so female members are not given, specifically the girl child. So this is how the digital divide is not just urban or rural divide, or not just the economic divide between the rich and the poor. It is also a gender divide. Typical Indian society. It is also a caste angle. You must also know, it also has a caste angle in digital connectivity, because the access to the agencies is very poor when it comes to the lower socioeconomic caste. And again, we can see another digital divide or deprivation of technology. So on the basis of caste, this is also an unfortunate thing, but this is a ground reality and we must accept it. Only when we will accept it, we will have a solution for it. So this is how a progressive thinking is made. First, acknowledge that there is a problem, and then only you can think of a solution over that problem. IPR, Industrial Policy Resolution of 1956 is very important because it was based on the PC Mahalogdis model. Rest of the thing, I don't think that they are relevant in any form. That's why I am not giving much of the time. They have not asked IPR policy in the whole of the UPSC canvas. So we will make a leap of faith and we will skip this part. Just remember that IPR 1956 was an important thing. It was because it was based on Mahalogdis model, and this was also a Himalayan mistake for our policy. Now, a new industrial policy of 1991 is another important thing. Where LPG reforms were made, where liberalization is the philosophy, privatization is the path, and globalization is the ultimate aim to reach by walking on this path with this philosophy. IPR, they are not asked, and I don't think that this is much important. Names, saves, sees, they have never asked this thing. Infrastructure, very important thing. Just remember, infrastructure has been given the status of logistics by the cabinet committee or the union cabinet. No, it's reverse. Logistics has been given the status of infrastructure by the Union Cabinet last year. Why? Because the infrastructure status is very important to get the benefit of various government policies and also cheap low interest from the commercial banks. And that is how a sector is developed, just by giving it a status of infrastructure. Also, in Atmanirbhar Bharat and before that also, ambitious resolution was made by our finance minister while presenting the union budget that India will spend 1 lakh crore rupees only on infrastructure in coming 5 years to make India a $5 trillion economy. $5 trillion economy. 1 lakh crore in coming 5 years on infrastructure to make India $5 trillion economy, because infrastructure is the bedrock of economy. After human resource, this is another most important resource. So what are economic infrastructure? Any financial system and related to it. So examples are power, transportation, irrigation, communication, anything which supports commerce, economic infrastructure. What are social infrastructure? Economic infrastructures are tangible. You can see it, you can feel it. It's a concrete, it's a hard infrastructure. Social infrastructures are somewhat intangible, like health, education, the human capital, the human values. So producing more doctors, more scientists, more engineers, more technologists, also producing good sports people who will go out in society and promote healthy lifestyles. So all these intangible aspects of social infrastructure. Contribution, this chart, rural infrastructure, a bit different from urban infrastructure, but the philosophy remains same. National infrastructure pipeline. Question. Yes. As I just mentioned, this thing, same thing what I have said, investment of okay, it's not 1 lakh crore, sorry, my mistake, it's 100 lakh crore, sorry. So 100 lakh crore over the next 5 years, this is unveiled by our finance minister last year. So energy, road, railway and urban infrastructure under National Infrastructure Pipeline, NIP. Also there is a fund, there is some fund which started with a purpose of 40,000 crore in 2013. Just Google it. The proceeds of the disinvestment will go to in this fund. Something like this NIIT. UPSC has asked question in 2017 on this concept. This fund. I will get back to you. I am not able to recall it. But it is also an infrastructural fund. 40,000 corpus and started in 2013, and the proceeds of disinvestment will go in that fund. Hurdles, financial positions, where 100 lakh crore are going to come from, this will always remain the challenge. That's why I use the word ambitious resolution. This was an ambitious resolution, but how far it is pragmatic in coming years you will see. This can never happen without private investment. This will also form a major driver. States cooperation, yes. Financial federalism, when fused with cooperative federalism, then only out of states cooperation, because India is a unit and India is a federal unit. States form a huge, huge economic activity. And huge proceeds, nets and proceeds are being diverted towards the states by the center. So they also form the one of the major source of revenue as well as expenditure both. Investment models, public investment, private investment, PPP. Here the government will invest, private, here private party will be. Public-private investment, public PPP. Public-private investment, this is the model. which is in prevalent use in nowadays. Neither government is going to 100% invest nor private sector, but in some fusion or hybrid model between them. So these are very technical details. BOT, Build Operate Transfer, hybrid annuity model, HAM, and something like what also, what do we engineer? This is hybrid annuity model, and build, operate, transfer. This is one another model, but you don't need to require. These are technical details, and you just never go into technical details. What is the process of finances? Just read it for basic understanding, but you will not need it. No, definitely not need it. You never asked, you're never going to ask. No. Yeah, this is, no, this is the question that every year, UPSC is asking directly or indirectly in prelims. Savings rate, tax rate, inflation, interest, capital. Why this affects investor sentiment? See, if a country saves a lot, where it saves? It saves in the banks. So banks has more money to lend. This is that banks have more money to lend. They are taking from you on 6% interest rates. They are giving it to me on 10% interest rate. 4% they are making their own profit, and 6% they are giving you as an incentive. And I also get money to use for my business enterprise. And this is how, when you save more, banks will have more money, so that they will lend me more. This is how I will invest it on many things. This is how manufacturing or will set up, or business will set up. This will lead to employment generation, means job growth, means people will have again more money in their hand as a disposable income, which will again have more money, more salary, means they will save more. And this is again, bank will have more money and they will lend me more. So a virtuous cycle will set up. So, but in India, savings rate from 2001 to 2019 has decreased from 32.5% to 29.7%. And this is worrisome picture. Consumption culture has boosted. We are now spending more. We are spending lavishly. One major factor is, I think, Facebook, Instagram has something to do for at least 0.2% of this decrease in saving, because to get a photogenic, a pictographic location, you need to go a place with good ambience. There is nothing wrong in going in a place of good ambience, but doing it a regular affair without having any source of income is not a good thing. So this is one thing. Saving rates are decreasing in our country, which is not a good sign. Tax rate in country. Lafarge curve. Just remember. Interest rate of bank interest rates. If lending is expensive, then I won't take the loan. Possible rate of return on capital. Every prospect is good, but I have anticipation that there will not be a possible rate of return on capital. Other factors, cheap land, labor, etc., etc. This other factors of production, the Tata Nano project. Tata Nano was moved overnight out of some Singnur, West Bengal, to Gujarat because of the political disruption there. So all these factors affected. So this is how we have come to an end of our economy, prelim-based economy. So I think someone earlier has asked for explaining balance of payment. So balance of payment BOP. You will try to understand it through an example. You know, India has trade surplus with America. So, $35 billion. $35 billion. But interest and service sector, again, we are not surplus there. For example, India and USA. Are transacting a business where India needs to give $100 to USA, USA needs to give India $75. So India has, say, India is getting 75, but it needs to pay 100. So the deficit of 25. So the deficit of 25 is called as balance of payment, BOP. The net of its forex reserves, foreign exchange reserves. It may be positive and it may be negative. Mostly for India, it is negative. So 25 is balance of payment. From where we are going to get this 25? Again, India will ask for loan from any other country or any other international financial institution like World Bank or IMF. Mostly IMF deals with the balance of payment thing. So again, IMF will lend India $25, and this is how India will pay successfully USA payment of $100. Another measure why is to make this figure big. India is giving only, India is exporting to USA trades and services only worth of $75. So we need to make innovation, research and development, so that our products will become so good and productive that the Americans will have affinity for Indian products. And even if we make this 90, so see, we will need to borrow only $10, because BOP out of 100 minus 90 will be $10 only. And someday will come when India will get 100 from USA. USA need to pay 50. So this will be a positive situation in coming time. I hope it will come. So this is BOP. Another thing UPSC has once asked, many in 1990s, I guess, BOP of world as a single unit. This will always remain zero. This will always remain zero. How? Country one is giving country two something. That means country one is being debited and country two is credited with equal amount. So someone is losing $1,000, means in other words, another country is gaining $1,000. So balance of payment for country A is $1,000 debit, and balance of payment for country 2 is $1,000 credit, but balance of payment for world is zero. Though as a world, in world, the transaction remains same, utna hi paisa idhar tha, utna hi paisa bas udhar chala hua. But world mein paisa nahi tha. So BOP of world is zero. So this is how we have now completed our economy. I think tomorrow will be just doubt and discussion session, and then there will be end to our this module of economy. It was tomorrow we will have doubts and discussion. You can ask me anything what we have studied here. Okay, so now we will stop.